A lot is happening at SpaceX's Boca Chica spaceport this week, but two things stand out in particular. Of course, one is the stacking of Starship SN8, and the other thing is this interesting white-painted Starship nose cone with the US flag and NASA logo. Very hard to guess what it could be for. In other news, Starlink 14 has launched successfully 6 days ago, and Starlink 15 has launched today after having been scrubbed the last time. But you know who faces more severe scrub problems?
That's right, ULA. Their NROL-44 satellite mission still hasn't launched yet. But at least ULA has some good rhetorics, which they recently showed at their Q3 earnings call. And Blue Origin is trying to convince the US Air Force to continue investing in them. At NASA, meanwhile, OSIRIS-REx successfully touched down on asteroid Bennu. And NASA signed a memorandum of understanding with the Department of Energy for building radio-isotope thermo-electric generators for use on the Moon and Mars. A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
A lot has happened since the last update from Boca Chica, so let's get right into it. The first historic static fire test of 3 sea-level Raptor engines at once has been a full success on Tuesday, October 20th, lighting up the surrounding area in a bright light, as impressively seen on these cool recordings here by the amazing Lab Padre team. Please go and check out their channel, link in the description. So now that the test has been a full success, the real fun is starting. Starship SN8 has gotten the nose cone attached just yesterday, and now SN8 is standing there in full glory. I mean, just look at the size of this thing. The only time we've seen a fully assembled Starship prototype before had been with the Mark 1, which then unfortunately met an untimely demise. But SN8 is a totally different beast. We can see that the steel welds have a much higher precision, and the steel surface is a lot smoother than had been the case for MK1. This is a testimony to SpaceX's radical pace of improvement with steel construction and welding methods over the last year. So now basically, it won't be long until the 15-kilometer flight test will happen. This test will be really important as it will test the crucial skydive and subsequent belly flop maneuvers, which is a crucial part of Starship atmospheric re-entry. The chances that the test will go as planned are pretty good, which would be a huge milestone for the Starship program.
Apart from SN8, something else caught many people's attention. There is a white-painted Starship nose cone at Boca Chica. The nose cone also has the American flag and the classic right worm NASA logo painted on. So what's going on? Well, we think, and actually some sources at Boca Chica confirmed this, that this is intended to be a mock-up of the already now legendary Moonlander version of Starship. The mock-up is being assembled because NASA will send some people over to check up on the progress regarding the Moon Starship. We remember that SpaceX is one of the only 3 contenders who was selected by NASA and awarded money to build a moon lander for their Artemis moon program, which foresees returning humans to the moon by 2024. The other contenders being Dynetics with their really good moon lander called Alpaca, and the team with the very patriotic name National Team, consisting of very slow but very expensive companies like Blue Origin, Lockheed and Northrop. That's why we like to call the latter the lobby team instead of the national team. But of course, you can decide how you want to call them. In any case, it's pretty evident how insanely superior the Moonlander version of Starship is compared to the other contenders. The payload capability of Starship to the lunar surface is at least 100 metric tons, compared to probably a maximum of only a few metric tons at best for the other 2 moonlanders. Interior volume-wise, it's also pretty clear that Starship just completely obliterates the other moonlanders. While both the Dynetics Alpaca lander and the Lobby lander have considerably more interior volume than our good old Apollo lunar module, Starship has 1,000 cubic meters of interior pressurized volume. As a comparison, the Apollo lunar module had 6.65 cubic meters, or 235 cubic feet of interior volume. So you know, a relaxed factor of 150 more than the Apollo lunar module, and probably a factor of at least 50 more than the other two moon lander contenders.
But at the same time, Starship, due to its full reusability, will be cheaper to build. Because of all these factors, NASA is of course really interested in having a moon variant of Starship as a possible vehicle to land humans on the moon in 2024. With Starship, NASA would have the capability to land dozens of people on the moon at the same time. Many metric tons of science experiments, habitat modules, and pressurized rovers all at once. This would enable NASA to build an Artemis moon base much faster than with the other lander solutions. But of course, this radically new design also means more risk for NASA. That's why they want to inspect the progress of Starship at Boca Chica, and this white nose cone here will be the first step towards convincing NASA that indeed the Starship moon lander is superior to the other landers. So having a mockup of lunar Starship is a really good idea, and hopefully NASA will understand that despite the higher risk, Starship is just a too good moon lander solution to ignore. NASA will decide in March next year with which contenders to continue for the Artemis program. Jim Bridenstine said that he wants to continue with at least two out of the three teams. Let's just hope that NASA will be smart and include SpaceX in those at least two teams. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because if you subscribe, you will be able to vote on the topics for our Wednesday videos, which we'll do from now on again due to popular demand, the topics ranging from disruptive technologies such as Hyperloop or electric cars to spaceflight or astro topics of any kind. Even aliens. We'll post the topics once per week on our YouTube page. So thank you very much for your support.
In other news, Starlink 14 successfully launched 6 days ago, but the first attempt of Starlink 15 had been scrapped, the reason being an issue with the onboard camera. But with a high probability, the mission has been launched by the time this video is released, on Saturday, the 24th of October. The number of Starlink satellites stands at 835 before Starlink 15, and at 895 after Starlink 15. So the magical 1000 threshold is really not far away anymore. Starlink is already in beta testing right now and shows some really good latency and speed data. The US military is of course highly interested in Starlink, where tests are also underway to have Starlink dishes attached to some military units. By the way, Starlink connectivity will also work on moving objects, so on trains, buses, trucks, and so on. Probably the engineers over at Tesla are already thinking about how to install inconspicuous Starlink connectivity into all Tesla cars at some point in the future.
Okay, so scrubs happen sometimes, you know? SpaceX is normally fixing problems really fast, with Elon coming to inspect the launch site himself in person if things don't work out as planned with a launch. In contrast, ULA's Delta IV Heavy rocket remains grounded since months now, with no end in sight. ULA should have launched the NROL-44 spy satellite for the National Reconnaissance Office already in June. But after 5 scrubs, the rocket still remains grounded, and the new launch date has not yet been fixed. This is of course not very good for ULA's reputation of being a reliable launch provider. So what do we do when things start to look bad? Of course, we increase the propaganda efforts, which ULA did in the recent third quarter earnings call with analysts on October 20th. There, the CFO of Lockheed Martin, Kenneth R. Posenreed, said, quote, "We now have a price point that will allow ULA to get its fair share of awards over SpaceX." Well, we'd say the fact that ULA still launches, or rather tries to launch, satellites for the US government has not so much to do with an attractive pricing strategy, but more with the US government's reliance on companies with whom they have worked together for decades. You know, kind of like, why change something which we have known already since 60 years now?
And of course, ULA, being a joint venture of Boeing and Lockheed, there are huge political interests going on in the background. Because many, many jobs in the aerospace industry depend on ULA. But Posseridge also said this during the earnings call. Quote, "We have seen SpaceX as an emerging threat. There are more than an emerging threat right now." Wow, that is finally some honesty there. Others who have problems are Blue Origin. Blue Origin is a company that was founded in the year 2000, 2 years before SpaceX. Yes, Blue Origin is actually older than SpaceX. Yet, all they have achieved until now are suborbital test flights with their new Shepard rocket.
That's a penis.
That's ridiculous. There's no way this majestic rocket can be confused with the male organ of love.
We don't have to summarize what SpaceX has achieved and continues to achieve in a shorter time. Every time when we see people comparing SpaceX with Blue Origin, as if they were on the same level, we instantly know that these people have absolutely no clue. Blue Origin's New Glenn, which is planned to be their first rocket to reach actual orbit, is still very far away from being ready. That's why the Air Force chose SpaceX and ULA to carry out their future satellite launches and neglected Blue Origin and Northrop. Jeff Bezos, of course, doesn't like that. So apparently, Blue Origin is trying to convince the Air Force one last time to continue funding their New Glenn development. It looks like Jeff will have to start pouring more of his earnings from Amazon into Blue Origin, if he wants Blue Origin to play any role in the future of space exploration.
At NASA, meanwhile, the asteroid sample return mission OSIRIS-REx has successfully touched down on the asteroid Bennu and apparently managed to collect some asteroid soil samples. The collected samples will be returned to Earth on the 24th of September 2023. OSIRIS-REx didn't really land on Bennu, more like brushed over the surface, briefly touching it long enough to collect the samples. This is a really fascinating mission, and let's see what they will find. We suspect lots of organic molecules because we found that asteroids are carrying the building blocks of life. And there is a very plausible theory which actually suggests that the building blocks of life were brought to Earth by asteroids. And those building blocks then evolved into DNA and then into single-celled and then multi-celled organisms. So the soil samples might turn out to be quite interesting.
Regarding Artemis, NASA teamed up with the Department of Energy and signed a memorandum of understanding in order to develop space-grade radio-isotope thermo-electric generators for the moon, because solar panels alone might not provide enough electricity. Such RITEGs will provide 10 kilowatts of continuous energy each for space colonies on the moon, and of course also for the future SpaceX colonies on Mars.
And there's not only progress on the Moon Starship, but also on the Mars Starship, and Elon has given some very interesting updates on that topic. We talked about it in this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report. And if you didn't know yet, tomorrow we will be hosting our first ever live stream onto the future.
So then see you tomorrow in the live stream, and then I would say on to the future.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.